Hi, I am Erwin Deense, founder of HiLogic. Thank you for joining me today. HiLogic is an independent software vendor based in the Netherlands. We produce Windows-based software that allows you to create and edit and manage fonts. So we have a font manager, but our flagship product is our font editor, Font Creator. I developed the first release of it back in 1997 as my graduation project. Over the years, it has evolved into a more advanced font editor than it was at first, of course. People appreciate the user interface, the robustness, and the tools aimed to create and edit your OpenType layout features. Since a lot of font designers use a Mac, not all of you are familiar with our product. So during this demonstration, I will focus on finding and solving OpenType layout features issues with Font Creator. But you will also see a glimpse of other basic and advanced features. At the end, I will show you a preview of the next upcoming major version that we intend to release early next year.
The first font is Castoro, made by John Hudson, which is released under the SIL Open Font license. I will now open the unified font object of one of the first public releases. The OpenType Designer, along with our native shaping engine and interactive OpenType layout proofing, allow you to create, edit and test complex script fonts. Well, the included features via file did not contain OpenType layout features. Those were included in a separate Vault project file. We can just drag and drop it to open it. I want to know if the compiler detects potential issues, so I click the syntax check toolbar button. As you can see, it generates two warnings. Duplicate input in this context means there is already a substitution defined with the same input. Let us find the first entry to see why there are duplicates. Okay, so the first entry should contain an uppercase G. That solves one of the problems. And let's look at the other one. Here we see actually the opposite. This should have been a lowercase I. So let's fix this as well and click the syntax check. There are no more warnings. Now we have to confirm if the problem is solved, and we use some specific text. We have to enable the CCMP feature, and we can indeed see the issue is solved. So this all looks great, but what if we did not modify the original code? Alright, well, we drag and drop the same Vault project file and we just hit OK. Now we see the original, and that indeed has two issues. I have reported these issues a couple of weeks ago and John Hudson told me he has fixed the problems. Just to confirm this, we can open the latest version of Castoro. Yes, indeed, the issues are fixed. However, now on the left side, we see within the features, all lookups are duplicated. So there is somehow another problem. Probably caused by the newly used build process of the font. Maybe a problem in font make or in the features file. He is investigating the issue. Okay, the second font comes from Bhikkhu Pasala. He is one of the most generous and helpful people I know. All his fonts are free, but subject to the copyright under the GNU license. Pali is a version of Herman Zapp's Palantino, designed for body text in Buddhist publications. It contains stylistic alternates with color, and it contains smart fractions. Let us jump to the smart fractions. Okay, so we have to enable the frac feature to see what it looks like. I want to extend the fraction feature in a way that it will also support the zero with a slash. Right now, if we enable the zero feature, you will see it will break the fractions. In order to edit, we have to do some addition to the OpenType layout feature code. The required glyphs already exist in the font, so we can jump straight to the fractions feature. The feature works with fine with the regular digits, but the slash zero fails. We need to include a substitution for the top 0, 0, the numerator subs, and for the bottom, the denominator subs. So here we have to add this one. And here we have to add this one. Now it's not all working because in the context chaining context lookups, we also have to include the specific glyphs. Therefore, we have to go to the glyph classes. This is one, and the order is to the denominators. Okay, so now we see the slash zero is also working in the fractions feature. The next font I want to show is Kahiri. It's a Kufic typeface based on the modernized and regularized old manuscript Kufic calligraphy style of the late master of Arabic calligraphy, Muhammad Abdul Qadir. Kahiri is a free and open source project under the terms of version 3 of the GNU license. Within the OpenType Designer, we open the original features file. And since we are mainly interested in possible issues, I again click the syntax check toolbar icon. There are several hints and warnings. Most are informative, but the first couple are suspicious, so let us double click on them to see the underlying code. In case you are not familiar with the Adobe OpenType feature file specification, this code is related to GPOS lookup type 5, mark to literature attachment positioning. So here, the first component did not get a set of anchor mark class pairs, while the second one got two sets. So let us first ignore the warnings and just accept the feature code. I have prepared the preview text since we have limited time. Here you see the preview text without the shaper enabled. When we enable the shaper, you will see how it will look like. Okay, so the preview contains a ligature with a Hamza mark above and another ligature with a Hamza mark below. Both are second ligature components. This at first looks fine, but when we use alternates that are involved with the warnings, we suddenly see what goes visually wrong. So here you see the marks on the left side of the ligatures, which is correct in this case. Here it is also correct, but all of a sudden with this specific alternate, the move to the right, and that's wrong. So let's re-import the feature code to try and fix the problem. To fix the problem, I just have to move the lib component keyword along with the set to the correct position. There were four of them. Okay, well, let's double check. The warnings related to the lib component are now gone. So we press the OK button. And now we see the marks are indeed positioned correctly on the left of the ligature. So that's working. I reported this issue and Khaled immediately fixed the problem. So next, I want to show the upcoming version of Font Creator, which will support variable fonts and it can be expected early next year. This variable color font comes from a Dutch type designer, Arthur Reinders Volmer. He is a true ambassador of the combined technology of variation and color. He has made numerous variable color fonts, and Bloom is one of my favorites. The font contains one interesting glyph, as you can see. It is a multi-mapped glyph, both mapped to the upper and lowercase letter G. There are three masters, and all of the glyphs that are used to make up the color glyph have outlines for all of those. So when I open this, you can see all the layers that are used to make up the color font. We can use the slider to instantly see how it is interpolated. Okay. Next, another font, the last one, which is Sudo. This is also a variable font designed by Jens Kutilek, which is licensed under the SAL Open Font license. It is a monospaced font designed for terminal and programming. On his website, he states it's far from finished, so you are more than welcome to help improve it. When we move the sliders, you can see the acute and the ring marks go wrong at some point. People familiar with multiple master fonts and variable fonts will already know why it fails, but to understand the issues, let us open one of the composite glyphs and dig into it further. I jump to the glyph member. This is also a composite glyph, so I jump into this one as well. And here we end up with the glyph that is causing the problem. This ring combining mark has a regular layer and several other layers, and here the starting point is at the top, but the other layers all have the starting point at the bottom. So We can easily fix the problem by also setting the starting point at the bottom for the regular layer. And as you can see in the preview, the issue is instantly fixed. We can do the same for the acute. Again, we have to jump to the actual glyph that's causing the problem. Here you see in the layers, the starting point is at the left bottom, except for the bold and the regular versions. So here we also fix the first point. And we see this problem is fixed as well. I did report the issue, and Jens has already released a new version that solves the issue. Another neat thing deeply hidden in the variable font is the usage of feature variations. This is a special extension to the regular OpenType layout features in cases where it's hard or impossible to provide two layers from where you can interpolate. In general, an additional feature known as a required variation alternates is added to the font, which contains a substitution lookup. We can see from the sliders what will happen with the F. And we can also enable the proofing tool, which will reveal exactly what happens within the shaper. So we are now at the end of the demonstration. I hope there's some time left for you to provide feedback and to ask questions. First, a summary. Font Creator is a powerful font editor that can also be used to find and solve issues related to OpenType layout features. Key areas in this respect are the visual OpenType designer, the decompiling and recompiling of feature code, and of course the OpenType proofing tool. More than 500,000 fonts have been produced with our software, so it's likely that you have several of them in your font collection. Even part of the Noto font family is based on fonts made with Font Creator. Font Creator is made to run on Windows, but there are ways to use it on a Mac. Thank you.
Well, I'm glad to hear all that positive feedback from you. Are there also more specific questions related to the demonstration I gave about the OpenType layout features? I pre-recorded the video, of course, and later I noticed that I probably forgot to include the proofing tool, which is also a very important part of the of the OpenType layout feature utilities we provide. Okay, great. So, sorry for all the, well, the attempts to make it work. It's the first time I'm doing a conference, and this conference is of course online, so it's all very new to all of us, of course. Well, this is in Font Creator 13, the current version. I've opened Kahiri again to also show you the proofing tool. In the proofing tool, you will see all the lookups that are applied in the correct order, and you will also see the end result. And you can you can also say to the proofing tool to only process the lookups until a certain point. So for example, if you want to see only this part of the applied features, I click the selected the toolbar button here, and then you will notice in the preview that it is applied until including with the init feature, but not with MEDI and FINA. And so you can move to this. You can also step through it to see how the original, how the initial unprocessed OpenType lookup layout features are
put into the preview. And also when you click on one of the items, you will also immediately jump into it in the OpenType Designer. So you can look at it, you can change things instantly. I have two screens usually, so then it's much easier to have a good workflow. Now one window is floating above the other. That's kind of annoying. So for example, if we think we need to reposition this Hamza above, then we can move it. Good example, where is it? Okay, so I was moving the first one while I should have moved the second one. So now you can also see it in the preview instantly, here as well, that you can interactively edit your OpenType layout features. And you can even see that the features are indeed changing. Some other things are contextual lookups, like I showed in the Pali font. And those are more complex. And in the demonstration, I did not put a lot of time into explaining that part. So it's also interesting to see here the fractions, how they work. Okay, so here are the fractions. And you can see that there is a chaining context lookup. Okay, I'll place it here. And that consists of an input field and a look ahead in this case. And when this condition is met, then the substitution tables, the lookups that are defined here, those will be applied. So that's how the OpenType lookup features work when they are contextual. When we want to see the /0, well, it's not working, of course, because this is the original font, but here you see that it is not working, but you do see the 8 is working, for example. If you only want to see all the rules that are being applied to this specific glyph, then just click it and that is instantly filtered out. So you can see what is happening. I can use the shift key as well to just investigate these two. If I am interested in this one, I can see that indeed it is being applied from a regular 0 to the 0,0, but there are no other features that are taking it into account. If I apply the if I add it to this class, like I did during the demonstration, then you will see at some point, well, not right now, at some point you will see that it is going to be taken into account. Let me go to the fractions features. Here are the lookups that are part of the fractions. Are there any specific questions related to the OpenType layout features or the proofing, or do you want to see another font or different characters, or do you want to see more from the variable font technology that we are building into Font Creator 14? So here you see all the masters that are within the font. This is sudo again. And when you go through those masters, you also see them in the correct coordinates. When you make changes to a specific layer, for example the bold one, you can move you can move your points on. This version does not move the points, but when you do so, that's of course fine, and it should be reinterpolated. You see the regular one is being moved. But if you change the, well, this is not funny. If you change the curve from on to off curve, then it's no longer a fully compliant glyph. So then you will see issues and you have to fix them. Well, at the moment we're working at this specific part of Font Creator, so it's not really working as I wanted to show you. Okay, let me see the questions. I'm not sure about the others, but if you have any IndexScript projects. Well, there are two questions. One is about specific scripts, IndexScripts. We are mainly producing a font editor, and we are not making our own fonts, so we don't have them here. But if you can point us to one that is open source and that we can download, then I'll be happy to do that right now. About the other question, if people are able to use nested components. Yes, of course. As I showed in the demonstration, it's not really a great example, but this glyph is actually defined here. Okay, this is a simple one, so this is not a good. Okay, here we go. So this glyph is actually defined in this, and here you can go to the source one. So the A ring is using glyph 937, and that one is just a single glyph that is 902. So if you change this one, well, today things are not working as I want them to work. But if you make changes here, they should be reflected here. Now, for some reason, it's not really updating right now. Working on it. Are there more questions? Okay, the features are automatically generated. That's a good question. Let me first get rid of Font Creator 14. So, we can remove all OpenType layout features, and then we can choose to generate a bunch of them. We can choose to select all, or we can choose to generate only a few. You can generate fractions, swash. It all the like all other font editors. The generation is mostly based on the glyph names. So 25 years ago, glyph names were actually also intended to be put into the font, so they were actually the required. I think they were called PostScript names. It was stored in the post table, but nowadays that is still possible. But on export, the font editors will ensure that the valid glyph names are stored into the font if that's necessary. So when you're working on a font, the glyph names are mainly for your usage. So they should be friendly so you can see them, you can understand what the glyph is, even without inspecting the actual character code point. So it's very important for the OpenType feature generation that the glyph names are defined in a way that this feature generator will understand them. Another thing is, of course, the marks. And if you have anchor classes defined, then it is also possible to generate these kinds of features. So it's not only the glyph names, but also the anchors and the anchor names. Now, in this case, the fraction feature is generated. You can see it in the code editor. The code editor, we have three different feature code syntaxes that we support. This is our own syntax. It's based on one from Rogier van Dalen. This is, of course, the most commonly used feature syntax from Adobe. You can compile this one and make changes to this one, and then you can make changes to this one, and you can even use the Vault syntax. This one is not really user friendly because, well, as you see, it's actually not meant to be manually edited, I think, but it's possible. It's a scripting syntax, so. Well, I cleared all the OpenType layout features, and in that action, I also removed all the anchor classes. If we want to generate anchor-based positioning, then we need to add them again. So what we can do, most easy, is, did I cancel? Okay. So I did not cancel, I did cancel, so everything is still available. Let me clear it and click OK. Now all is gone, so no OpenType layout features. And let me generate anchor-based reposition. Now font creator will calculate, will determine if it can find specific characters to add anchor-based positioning. In this case, all these selected characters have been applied. So it's a whole bunch, mostly Latin-based. And we can also go into detail here and see the anchors. So here's a bottom and a top anchor that has been automatically generated. When you go here, you see a top and a bottom. And in the A, you can see the same. So we have three. Hope you can see it. We have three. If we make changes to this one, obviously this changes too. But if we change the top, this one is not changing. That's because this is a one-time generation. If we want to keep them in sync, we can make it auto-attach. And in this case, it will keep in sync. The OpenType layout features are, if I enable the shaper, that's the default, then what you see is it will use normalization. So even before processing the OpenType layout features, it is already combining the G and the brief combining mark into this composite glyph, the G brief. And the same for the lowercase. So it's actually, well, sometimes it's fooling you because you think things are working, like how we now want to see if the anchor-based positioning is working. Well, it's not being applied right now because the shaper already changed it into another glyph. So we have to disable the shaper to see if the features will work if your font ends up in a shaping engine that does not include normalization this way. So we then have to enable the mark. That's obviously the most important one. And you see that it applies this this mark to base lookup. Okay, so here we see the values that were defined when we clicked the auto generate the auto composite, the anchor based composite feature, to regenerate all the anchors, and the same for the lowercase and all the other characters that are in here, of course. So you can go to all of them. You can make changes if necessary. There are also mark to mark, so in case you, let me see, if you put two on top of each other. Now you will see the first one is applied and the second one is applied, but they are both applied at the same position. That's because only the letter mark top lookup is applied, and it's pretty dumb. It applies it at the same position. So therefore the mark to mark one has to be applied as well. And now you can see you have to watch the G and the two marks above. Now it's one. Actually, it's two exactly placed on top of each other, two marks. And now one is positioned above the other. And that's because of this mark to mark feature that's also being applied right now. And you can also see it here that it's being applied. Another thing is the CCMP. That's another smart trick that uses a smaller version of your mark in case it sees it's being used by a capital letter, because that better fits. And those features, well, here is one. It's the lookup and it's being applied because of this match. And this is all auto-generated. When we when we clear this and we generate all features, it has to think, okay. So then this is all being auto-generated. It even contains localization. Let me see. Okay, yeah. So if you are if you know how to name your glyphs, then well, Font Creator can do a lot of smart things for you.